Hi folks, this is David Kwan here to talk about Watch Dogs. I know there's a little delay. Sometimes my MacBook camera does this weird thing where it kind of freezes the frame and pauses it, and I'm still talking, so the audio is still recording, but the video is not recording. I don't know why it does that. But anyway, to the point of talking about Watch Dogs, which I played on PS3, and I talked a bit about the fact that like it's a very well-designed game in an open-world sense, but it doesn't blow expectations out of the water. You know, it's pretty interesting to be in Chicago. In an open world game, I think that's a first for me. I haven't ever been in Chicago in a video game universe before, so that's interesting. So, but it feels in a way too large, because it's just so much driving. I think with the concept that it had, it could have been a denser universe. Although I do like the kind of difference there is when you go to Pawnee, and there's a huge distinction. You know, it's like a rural suburban hillbilly area, you know, backwoods kind of an area compared to the urban city downtown district of Chicago, and the distinction to be made is there, which is pretty cool. At the same time though, it doesn't really feel that different from any other urban cities that you're in. It doesn't feel uniquely Chicago. I don't know how they can capture that. I've been in Chicago once, but very briefly, personally. So I guess that's harder. It's harder to sell to me, someone who hasn't been in Chicago. Whereas a game like Grand Theft Auto 4 or Grand Theft Auto 3, I'm in New York City. So when they depict Liberty City as being very identical to New York City, I can go to some spots and it's like, yeah, this feels very much like Times Square. This is how Brooklyn is, or the Bronx is. Grand Theft Auto is a series in which they actually depict the Bronx. Very few games who take place in New York City actually depict the Bronx. So I think that's amazing. But, you know, so I think that's a failure on my part, because I'm not very personally familiar with Chicago myself. So it doesn't feel uniquely Chicago. That might not be the game's fault per se, but that's the feeling that I had. The setting doesn't feel quite unique. Also, because there are a lot of, because of the mechanics of being able to use your phone to blow up underground sewers to stop the traffic, like because of the mechanics, I think there are also a lot of the similar architecture and similar kind of setups in the game's overall overworld level design. So that is one thing I think that didn't really pull me in as much. And also, you're driving so much. Like I said, it this could have been a game where it could have involved a lot more just kind of exploring and walking around, instead of having been such an expanse area with so much content. Like, that's kind of a filler material. And including, I think they have to check all the boxes. Like, oh, this game needs to be an open world game. This game needs to have boats. This game needs to have cars and vehicles and be super large. And we gotta in our promotional materials, we gotta hit up the fact that it's certain square miles big, you know. So I think they had to check all the boxes, is why the game ended up being the way it is. And they made it in the promotion like, the city is the weapon you could use with your hacking skills and your phone. But you know, that's also what makes the game really dull and kind of just repetitive. And just so draggy, I think, at parts. Like, the pacing is it just drags out. It's not a game that I want to 100% complete. And there are huge open world games that actually does compel me to 100% complete. Watch Dogs is not one of them. But I do find it very interesting and compelling to be in this universe where it's all operated under a single operating system which you can hack into. Not a lot of the hacking abilities are that, you know, you get used to them, the novelty wears up fairly quickly. But it's an interesting dynamic of having this character who has this, the game tries very hard to present Aiden Pierce as someone who has like a moral conscience, right? He's doing things that he thinks is right, but he, in some ways, sometimes he just has one particular goal, which for the majority of the game is to rescue his sister and his nephew, or keep them safe, right? And they're not safe, so he has to do kind of odd jobs for this old friend of his who is not his friend anymore, but he has to do it because it's for the benefit of his sister. So he has this one overarching objective, and he will do whatever it takes for that objective, and it's very jarring sometimes, just kind of seeing him, you know, dictate his, like, well, no, that's not the right thing to do, or that's the wrong thing to do, and you don't really get a choice. So you, it's more of like, I really like that there was no choice in this game, actually, that it's not a game of like, are you gonna make this Aiden Pierce into an evil asshole, or are you gonna make him into a goody two shoes? The binary choices that we have a lot of the times with characters, it can be problematic. I think it would have been problematic if it was that case with Aiden Pierce. If it's a fantasy game, something like Cole McGrath or in the Infamous universe, or whoever the new character is in Infamous Second Son, I don't know. That's one thing. But in a universe like this, it was very interesting to have a character who's practically a psychopath. Now, I can't make the distinction between whether he's a... I can't make a judgment whether he's a psychopath or a sociopath based on one thing. So I do not know if Aiden Pierce was always this way. Like, if he was since he was very, very young, that he was very, like, he'll do whatever he does to get his way, but also he does not really feel remorse, because that's the clinical definition. You know, you don't feel guilt or remorse for the actions that cause harm to others. You rationally think that, like, what is wrong or what is not right, you can do that, but the emotional capacity to feel guilt is missing with psychopath, practically from birth. You know, that's the distinction between psychopath and sociopath is that. Sociopath is usually, you develop later in life, in adolescence, or when you're 7 years old, probably later in your teenage years, you develop it because of social factors. That's why it's social. Psychopath, you have it developed since your whatever, it's your brain genetic wiring, but it's a typical. I think Aiden Pierce, I personally think, fits right into the clinical definition of at least sociopath. I can't really say for certain if he's a psychopath. There is some dialogues that happen between him and his sister that sister's like, you know, I've always, like, looked up to you and I always wanted to be in your group, but you kind of always shut me out from being part of what you were doing. I think that is kind of a hint into maybe, but it doesn't give a sense of, like, what his emotional well-being is. And in Watch Dogs, when you play the game, there are a lot of thoughts that go, he has internal monologues, like, oh shit, what did I just do? And that is it. That's the emotional impact. It's this more calculated kind of logical thinking, like, oh, you know, when I did, I just accidentally killed a whole bunch of people, or I just accidentally put my in harm's way, and in order to save her, I just mowed down these groups of people. I just killed so many people. And there is not, like, usually one-liner or two-liner that happens. There is that one instance where he goes out to save his nephew. He's in the subway trains, and there are all these guards going out to get him. Aiden Pierce chases him down and just murders everyone who's near the train. And then right after the shootout, you know, after the dust has settled, Aiden Pierce does his one-line monologue. It's like, oh shit, what did I just do? And that's it. That's kind of the remorse that is evidenced by Aiden Pierce. And it's story-wise, Watch Dogs for me, it's all over the place in a way. But I found that part to be quite compelling. To be in the shoes of Aiden Pierce was very uncomfortable a lot of times, and he does things that it's just like, holy shit, what are we doing? You know, and but it kind of drives the story forward and just presents the character of Aiden Pierce in a very murky way. I'm not sure if this was intentional. I think if it was intentional, then this was powerful. If it's not, I think it's very problematic if the intention is to kind of portray Aiden Pierce as some sort of a hero, like Nathan Drake. Although Nathan Drake, at least the second game, kind of tries to bring the notion of, like, well, you killed hundreds of people to get here. You know, what makes you think that you're better than I am, kind of thing. You know, it deconstructs the notion of the hero. But I think Watch Dogs, like, it was so palpable Like, as I was playing it, like, I was... There are some moments I'm just cringing. That's why when I was playing Aiden Pierce, and there's a lot of driving involved. And when you're driving and you're chasing other cars and you're having to do all these driving missions, I accidentally hit civilians a lot of times. And those result in death and civilians injured, and you get your ranking marked down. And that just made me feel, you know, that hit me emotionally. Like, oh my god, I just killed a civilian. That I normally would not feel in a typical Grand Theft Auto game. If I'm driving around and I accidentally hit, like, a civilian on the way or a goon, like, I just drive mow them down. Like, it's Grand Theft Auto games for some reason, or in Saints Row especially. Saints Row is, like, even more of a culprit. Like, oh, you know, it's just a video game, whatever, and I'm doing things. But Watch Dogs, like, oh my god, what did I just, you know, I was watching Conan, the Clueless Gamer. He's playing Watch Dogs, and he plays this one segment and about, of course, it's driving, because the game is so much about driving. And he just drives into this civilian and just flies over. The whole audience, and Conan himself, and the person, Aaron, I think, was just like, oh! You know, and I get that reaction with this game, too, if I'm driving and I accidentally hit a civilian. Like, it's just like, oh! You know, like, it feels so wrong in this game for that to happen. And even though Aiden Pierce is a sociopath, I don't think Aiden Pierce as a character would do that. Drive over civilians by accident and be totally, completely okay with that. I think, you know, because even though he can't feel guilt, he might be able to. I don't know. This is my personal armchair determination. I haven't actually... You know, Aiden Pierce is not real. I haven't met with him and talked with him in real life in a clinical setting and asked him questions and assessed him if he's sociopathic or not. So I have no idea if he can actually feel empathy or not. But I feel like he can't. And if he can, he probably calculates in his mind why certain actions are bad. And it's surprising he's surrounded by characters who don't really have a moral compass. Like his partner... he has two partners. I forget the name. There's the Asian contract killer guy, a fixer. He's not only sociopathic, he's sadistic, right? And then there's his former partner, and he's definitely, like, no moral compass, whatever. But you know, it's that's what I felt like was the most kind of one of the most compelling things about playing Watch Dogs and just seeing how this character unfolds over time, and he's surrounded by other sociopath and just pretty sadistic and minded people. But he's also very connected to his sister and his nephew, they're the normal people in this game. You know, everyone else is just, what the hell? You know, every character, other than the just regular passerbys, the NPCs, everybody else is just crazy sociopathic, except Aiden Pierce's sister and nephew, and ultimately they drive away and they're driven away. And of course the female hacker character, who I forget her name, you know, that was an interesting kind of a dynamic between Aiden Pierce and this woman character. And obviously Aiden Pierce doesn't really know how to interact with women at all. So that awkward kind of relationship that they had, which interesting. What really makes me think Aiden Pierce is a sociopath very near the end of the game. You know, I think it's like pretty much the second to last mission. There's a shootout at the graveyard, and the aftermath of that graveyard scene. Aiden Pierce just like, you know, just like, oh shit, I'm sorry that happened. And that's it. Like that's. That's it, you know, a significant person, you know, I don't know, I don't think any non-sociopathic person would react the way that he does. It's not something that you just go like, oh, that's horrible, and then you get over it, just like that. That's something that normal person, like non-sociopathic person, would feel extremely emotionally impacted by, which Aiden Pierce is not. And I thought that was a very interesting thing about this game, just playing and knowing exactly that I was controlling practically a sociopath, possibly a psychopath.